Okay, once again, greetings everyone. I'm Priyanka from Team Admis, and from today we are starting our complex preparation classes. So I hope we all know that this is just for Nepalese students. So if anyone who is not a Nepali citizen may leave the session, or else from today we'll be starting the preparation classes. And we have with us is our Professor Nimesh. He has worked in very esteemed universities in India, including RK University. And now I would like to hand this session over to him. So if you have any queries regarding COMPEX, then you can drop it in the chat box and we'll be addressing all those queries later. Nimesha, I made you the co-host. I hope you are here and I'm audible.
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon.
So thank you so much for joining.
Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon, students. And I'm really thankful to Admis Tech Team for, you know, providing me this wonderful opportunity to conduct the COMPEX session. So today we will be starting off with the mathematics portion. And to start off, let me just share the screen of my presentation. All right. So kindly confirm that my screen share is well displayed on your device and my voice is properly audible to everyone. For confirmation, students can type Y in the group chat window. Okay, thank you for the confirmation. Now, as and when, you know, it comes to mathematics portion and that too with the preparation for COMPEX examination, you need to understand the basic, you know, fundamentals at a very proper manner so that you will be able to crack out this examination with an ease. Okay, so as and when the examination for COMPEX is considered, we will be overlooking few of the contents like algebra, coordinate geometry, calculus, and vectors. Okay, so these are the things which we'll be looking forward to in our today's session. So let me check out what the number of participants have connected, and I can find, yes, so only 16 members are there. So anyways, let's wait for a minute so that rest of the you know, students can continue, and then we can proceed further if it is not an issue. All right, so as I've received the confirmation, so we are good to go now with the session. So students, in our today's session, we will be covering up the topics from algebra, that is the determinants, matrices, the permutation combination, and the binomial theorem. These are the topics which we'll be covering up in our today's session. So let's get started with the algebra portion. Now, as and when the determinant basic is to be considered, right? So in mathematics, we already know this thing pretty well, that the determinant is a scalar value that is a function of the entries of a square matrix, right? So whatsoever the value which we obtain after the determinant simplification, the value will be a scalar value. Now, as and when the order of determinants are considered, so first order determinant is comprising of only one row and one column, that is the singleton value itself, but we will not discuss that. We will discuss the second order determinant and third order determinants, which are of prime importance as and when this determinant portion is to be considered. Now the second order determinant symbolic representation is as per you can find on your screen, that is, it is to be written within this kind of signs, and this is the first row, first column. Okay, this is first row, second column. This is second row, first column. This is second row, second column. So these are the set of elements which are contained in the determinant of 2 cross 2. And make sure determinant is always A square. Okay, that means it comprises of the number of rows that is equal to number of columns. This is the basics which you already know. Now for the simplification of 2 cross 2 determinant, the fundamental thing which we need to look out, that is, you need to take the cross multiplication like this way, that is A1 and B2 will get multiplied. We will multiply these two elements minus with, we will multiply these two elements. Okay, that is A2, B1. Let's take an example. Let us say if I want to simplify the determinant as 2, 3, 5, 7. Okay. So what is the simplification value of this determinant? I will multiply 7 with 2. That gives me 14. Minus, I will multiply 3 with 5. That gives me 15. So 14 minus 15, that is minus 1, which is the resultant of this determinant. All right. Now for third order determinants, we have the determinant listed in the form of 3 rows and 3 columns. So let's cite an example to understand this fundamental properly. Let's say the determinant is offered to us like 3, 4, 8, 1, 5, 7, 2, 6, 3. Now to simplify this, we may utilize this fundamental which is listed over here. That is, I will take 3 very first. And then I will take the cross product of 3 and 5 minus 6 and 7. So I will list down this value, 3 into 5, that is 15, minus 6 into 7, that is 42, minus 4, I will take it over here. And then what I will do is, I will try to multiply 3 with this 1, okay? So just a minute, I will multiply this 3 value with 1 and multiply 2 value with 7 and then take their differences, that is 3 minus 2 into 7 is 14 plus 8 multiplied by, now I will take the cross product of the first 4 values, that is 1, 5, 2, 6. Okay, so what how to do this, that is 6 into 1, so 6 minus 2 into 5, that is 10, and then I will proceed with the further simplification steps. So these are the basics which you need to recap before starting it with the furthermost part of the determinants. Then after, the key points which we need to look out, that is finding of minors, cofactors, and these two theorems which we need to keep in mind. Now what is a minor? So minor, that means, let us say if it is a 3 cross 3 determinant, okay, let's say if it is a 3 cross 3 determinant, so I will write the A, B, C, D, E, F, and G, H, I. So to find the minor of this first element, okay, what we need to do, we need to remove the entries of the column and the row containing a given element of the determinant. That means I need not to consider B and C elements. I need not to consider this D and G elements. And for minor of A11, that is the first row and first column, what I need to write, that is the rest of the part which is provided over here, that is E, F, H, and I. Okay. So this is how we find the minor, and generally it is represented in the notation form as M11. Now what does this M11 indicate? M indicates minor of first row and first column. This is how we are supposed to read it. Okay. In a similar way, let's say if you are intended to find the minor from the second row and second column. So for that, let me once again cite an example. Let us say you are intended to find the minor of, once again, A, B, C, D, E, GHI. Now, if you want to find the minor of E, so E is the second row, second column. So I will write M22 over here. Then what I will do, I will not consider the elements which are just beside this element E. Okay, that is towards the left of element E, towards the right of element E, towards the above of element E and below of element E. These elements I will not consider. The elements which I'm not considering, I'm striking through it at present. So D, B, F and H, these are the elements I will not consider for my simplification purpose. And my minor of E turns out to be ultimately A, C, G, I. And then I can do the further determinant simplification process and obtain my answer. Okay, this is the fundamental part. Yes, very good. One of the students has answered it. So it is AC. If you simplify it, ACGI, then how it will be, it will get simplified. It is AI minus CG or GC. Okay, this is how we find the minor. Now to find the cofactor, the only difference is that you need to introduce minus 1 raised to I plus J. Now what is this I plus J? I indicates the row value and J indicates the column value of the given entity. Okay, so let's take an example by understanding of this cofactor. Okay, so let me cite an example over here. That is 1, 2, 3, minus 1, 4, 5, 2, 0, 3. Now let's say if I am intended to find the cofactor of 5. Okay, so I have cofactor of 5, I will write it like this way. C is the notation utilized for cofactor. Now 5 is posited in which part of this determinant? It is in the second row and third column. So I will write 2, 3. Now this 2 indicates the I value and this 3 indicates the J value. All right. So cofactor of 2 and 3. Okay, so cofactor of 5, that is given by minus 1 raised to I plus J. Now I value is 2, J value is 3. So I will write 2 plus 3. And then I will write the determinant value. Now how to write this determinant? We will neglect this minus 1 and 4, we'll neglect this 3 and this 3. And I will write the remaining values, that is 1, 2 and 2, 0. Okay, so if you do the further simplification, it is minus 1 raised to 5. Now, we know this thing pretty well that if minus 1 is having odd power values, then we have minus 1 as it is, and it is to be taken in product with this determinant value. So if you simplify this determinant, you will come up with the value as 0 minus 4. And ultimately, your final answer turns out to be 4. So cofactor of 5 is 4. Okay. I believe the fundamentals up to now are well understood by each and every student. Please confirm it. You can type Y for the confirmation in the chat window. All right. So the next thing which we will be looking across, that is the theorem which is provided to us, that is the value of any third order determinant can be obtained by adding the products of elements of any of its rows or columns by their corresponding cofactors. Okay, now these two theorems are of we can consider it as a kind of assistance for our simplification of MCQ type problems. Okay, but for further part of the determinant, let us explore few more fundamentals which will also guide you with the further simplification aspect, and also we will try to simplify few of the problems based on determinants. So let's proceed further. That is the fundamental which is known as Saras method. Now Saras method is utilized for simplification of 3x3 determinant. So once you do this process, you will come up with the determinant value. Okay, so how to solve this? Let's take a look. Now let's say if a determinant 3x3 is offered to you like this way: 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9. Okay, so you need to rewrite the first column and second column. As you can find over here, You need to rewrite the first column and second column once again. So I'm rewriting it right over here. That is 1, 4, 7 and 2, 5, 8. Okay. Now, if you do the further simplification in accordance with this, so how to simplify this? You need to multiply the diagonal elements, that is 1, 5, and 9. Okay, we'll multiply like this way, 1 into 5 into 9. So that is equal to 45. Okay. Then after, once again, we'll multiply B1 into C2 into A3. That means 2 multiplied by 6 multiplied by 7. And we will introduce this sign over here. So 45 plus B1 C2 A3, that is 2 into 6, that is 12. 12 into 7, that is 84. Once again, I will do the multiplication like this way. That is 3 into 4 into 8. So 3 into 4, that is 12. 12 into 8, that is 96. And I will keep the parenthesis over here. And then we will take the product this way. The diagonally, that is A3, B2 and C1. So 7 into 5 into 3. Okay. So 7 into 3, 21 into 5, that is 105. Plus, then we'll take the product like this way. That is 8 into 6 into 1. So 8 into 6 is 48. Okay. 48 into 1 is 48. And then we'll take the product like this way. 9 into 4. Into 2. So 9 into 4 is 36. 36 into 2 is 72. Now do the further simplification and ping me your answers in the chat window. What is the resultant value you obtain after simplification of this? Very good. Very good. So ultimately, we come up with the answer as 0. So Sara's method will guide you with the simplification of the determinant, 3 cross 3 determinant, and that too, you know, it can be considered as a shortcut technique rather than simplifying it the way which we see, which we have seen just before few minutes. Okay. So this approach is also good to go for simplification of any 3 cross 3 determinant, but make sure it is having a limitation. You can apply it very suitable for 3 cross 3 determinant. Okay. Now, next thing that you need to keep in mind, that is few of the operations and symbols. That is very first, Rij and Cij. Okay. Rij, that means row operation. Cij, that means column operation. That means if I write Rij, it readily indicates that is interchanging of ith and jth row. And similarly, if I write Cij, it indicates that the interchange of ith and jth column. Okay. Similarly, Ri to Ci, that means converting of every element of row to the corresponding column element. That is, let us say if I write R2 to C2. So what I mean ultimately, I'm converting the second row into the second column. The elements of row and column are interchanged. In a similar way, Ri into K, that means multiplying any particular row value with any constant K. Okay. Similarly, Cik indicates multiplying any column value with a constant K. Okay. And Rij, Kij, Rij into K and Cij into K, that indicates that to multiply each element of the ith row by a real number and to add them to the corresponding element of the jth row. Okay, so this thing we will understand with the help of the examples which are kept in the further slide. Now, looking forward to the properties of the determinant as a part of quick recap, that is, if all the elements, if all the rows of a determinant are converted into the corresponding columns, the value of the determinant value remains same. That means if we convert the row determinant in the form of column form, okay. So the value of the determinant will remain same. There isn't any change. Now, if two rows of a determinant or two columns of a determinant are interchanged, the value of the new determinant will be the additive inverse. This thing you need to keep in mind. It can be asked as a form of multiple choice. Okay, then the value of the determinant gets multiplied by k if every entry in any of its row or column is multiplied by k. Okay, now for next, the another part which we need to look out, that is, if any determinant is given to you like of this form, let's say it is a1 plus p1, b1 plus p2, c1 plus p3, then it can be rewritten in the form of a1, a2, a3, b1, b2, b3, c1, c2, c3, plus the rest of the elements of second and third row will remain same. The only change happens, that is, p1, p2, p3 will be there in the first row. Okay, so it gets our task easier for the simplification. Then after, if the corresponding entries in any two rows or columns are identical, the value of the determinant will turn out to be zero. That means, let's say if any of two rows or two columns are same. For example, let's say if the first row is 1, 1, 1, second row is 2, 3, 4, and third row is 1, 1, 1. So the value of this determinant turns out to be zero. This is the ultimate point with this property highlights. Then after, the value of a determinant does not change if any of its rows or columns is multiplied by a non-zero real number k and added to the other row or column. Okay, so if I perform the rij and k element, this operation if I perform, or cij k operation if I perform, then the value of determinant will not change. So these are the properties of determinants which one needs to look out before appearing for any of the examination. Okay, now let's proceed with the simplification of few of the problems on determinant. So the first problem offered to you, that is, let's say if the determinant is offered as A, B, and at the denominator, the third row, first column, we have AX plus BY. Then in the second row, we have B. Okay, in the second column, we have B, C, and BX plus CY. And in the third column, we have AX plus BY, BX plus CY, and 0. That is equal to 0. And also another condition is offered to you as AX square plus 2BXY plus CY square. Now, this value is a non-zero value. See, it is strictly given that it is not equal to 0. And A, B, and C elements belong to positive set of real numbers. Then, which amongst the given can be considered for our best response in lieu of this particular question? So how to simplify this kind of determinants? Let's try to observe. Okay, the first operation which you need to undergo, see, that is multiplying the first column with minus x and adding it to the third column. Okay, correspondingly multiplying the second column with minus y and adding it to the third column. So these are the operations we need to undergo. Then after, c1 add to c3 plus minus x c1, this we need to undergo simultaneously, and c3 gets turned to c3 plus minus y multiplied by c2. Okay, so after undergoing these multiple operations at the same time, you will come across this value. Okay, if you do the further simplification simultaneously, these two results will get zero. Okay, now how to do this? Let's have a look. Okay, this is the direct step which is provided over here. So I will do one more step for the better sake of understanding. So first operation which is offered to us is multiplying first. See, what I need to do, multiplying first column with minus x and then adding it to the third column value. Okay, so that turns out to be like this way. I'm writing it over here. So first column is A, I will multiply it by minus x and I will add to the third column value. Okay, so this first and second column will remain as it is. Okay, there isn't any change. I need to write it somewhere below so that no hindrance can occur. Okay, I'm writing it over here. A, B, AX plus BY, B, C, BX plus CY. And see, since the first, this element is multiplied by minus x and it is added to the third column over here. So positive ax, which is already over here, and it is in now, you know, operation with this negative ax. So this will ultimately nullify and result into zero. Okay. In a similar way, if you look out over here, then we have b gets multiplied with minus y. Okay. So what is this operation? It is the second column element, which is getting multiplied by minus y, and then we are adding it over here. Okay. So what happens ultimately, that it is plus by and minus by, that is also resulting into a zero value. So I will write zero over here. Okay. Then after, what we need to look out, that is the other part, that is b, which is resided over here, once again following the same operation. So bx plus cy, and it is in interaction with bx minus bx minus cy. So this element also turns out to be zero. And see, c3 is equal to c3 plus minus x into c1. Okay, so if you perform that, so minus x into already minus ax, that will give you minus ax square. Similarly, bx, okay, into minus x, that is equal to, it will ultimately result into minus 2bxy. And further simplification will result into minus cy square. So ultimately, it turns out to be ab0, bc0, and ax plus by, bx plus cy, and ultimately you return to this value. Now, if you take the determinant simplification across the third row, okay, so across this third row, if you do the further simplification, we are not supposed to consider this value, we are not supposed to consider this value, okay, so only these two elements will get multiply over here, and then ultimately it will turn out to be minus ax square minus 2bxy minus cy square, and then the c gets multiplied with a, my b gets multiplied with b, so it is minus b square. And once you do the further simplification, see, over from over here, you can take minus 1 common, right? So minus 1 can be taken common, so it results into ax square plus 2bxy plus cy square, and then after, it is ac minus b square, that is equal to 0. And since it is already stated in the question that this ax square plus 2bxy plus cy square is non-zero, so I will equate ac minus b square with 0. Okay, so once you equate ac minus b square with 0, and if you do the further process, that is, I will shift minus b square to right hand side, ac is equal to b square. So what does this indicate? What does this indicate? That the values a, b, and c are in which kind of progression? You can have your answers in the chat window. If AC is equal to B square result we obtain, then what is the progression? Very good, very good. Yes, it's always a GP. So your answer turns out to be finally that A, B, and C are in geometric progression, right? So these kind of questions may get asked to you in your examination. Moving ahead with the next question. I do believe that you are well versed with this question. If you have any query, you may discuss it right at this moment, or else we'll take your queries on a later stage. We'll at present continue with our session. Okay. So question number two, that is, if a plus b plus c equals zero, then one of the solutions of this particular determinant is what? So for as a part of further simplification, what we need to look out, once again, we'll do the operations as C211 and C311. And once you perform this operation, okay, that is multiplying second column by 1 and adding it to 1, and similarly multiplying third column by 1 and adding it to 1, you will come across this particular value, that is all the set of values of first column will turn out to be equal. Now, what you can do is you can take the a plus b plus c. See, since it is given that a plus b plus c is 0, so we can take this particular set value as 0, okay, in each and every row of the first column. So once you put 0 over here, it will turn out to be minus x minus x minus x as c1. Then you can easily further simplify. That is, minus x can be taken common and the entire first column can turn out to be 1. Okay. Now it's very easy for further simplification. You need to just observe that minus x, okay, can be one of the minus x can be one of the solution of this determinant. We can equate. See, this is ultimately a scalar value, okay, as determinant is a scalar value. We already know this thing pretty well. So what we can do is minus x into value of this determinant is equal to 0. But since this value is a scalar value, it is not equal to 0. So minus x is ultimately equal to 0. So we can say that x equal to 0. Okay. So this is how the solution for this question turns out to be option B. That is, one of the solution is 0. Okay. Proceeding ahead further with the next part, that is the matrices. Now, when it comes to matrix part or matrices part, we know this thing pretty well that matrix is an ordered regular array of numbers or functions. Okay. And the number of numbers or functions which we take in this matrices are known as the elements of the entries of the matrix. Okay. This thing we need to look out. And it can be of rectangular form. It is need not to be a square just like determinant. That means the number of rows and number of columns in a matrix can vary. Okay, it is not necessary that the matrix needs to be of two row and two column or three row and three column. No, it can be of one row and five column also, and it can be of five row and one column also. Okay, so let's proceed ahead with the types of matrix known to us. That is a row matrix. Row matrix are that kind of matrices we can consider wherein we have only one row and number of columns are extended up to infinity, or we can say that we have more than one column or two column, okay, wherein we can relate it with a row matrix. So it is always of the order 1 cross n. Similarly, for column matrix, we have the set of rows wherein we have only one column in our given matrix, right? We are not having more than one. We are not having more than one column in any column matrix. We have only one column in it, so it is of the order m cross 1. We have number of rows, but here we are limited to only one column. Then for the case of square matrix, what we need to look out that the number of rows and number of columns are equal. That means if a matrix has two rows and two columns, it can be considered as a square matrix. Now, what is a diagonal matrix? If we have Aij value equals 0, okay, that means every, I and j value is 0 wherever I is not equal to j. For instance, let me write a matrix over here for the better sake of understanding so that it will help you out. So let's say if the values are given like this way, 1, 0, 0, 0, 2, 0, 0, 0, 3. So this can be considered as a diagonal matrix. Okay, this can be considered as a diagonal matrix. Why? Because every element apart from this diagonal value is a 0. Okay, every element apart from this diagonal value is a 0. And it can also be written as diagonal of A11, A22, A33, up to AN. And that means number of rows it takes into that we need to observe over here. Okay, and it is also known as the principal diagonal, and it is always a square matrix. So make sure diagonal matrix is always a square matrix. Okay, this thing we need to look out. Then after, for A equal to Aij m cross n, B equal to Bij m cross n, we need to perform addition operation. It can be performed like this way. That is simply adding the corresponding elements of the given matrices. But make sure the order of the matrix must remain same. Okay, that means a 2 cross 3 matrix can have addition with 2 cross 3 matrix only. It cannot be added with a 3 cross 3 matrix. Okay, so this thing we need to keep in mind for addition or subtraction processes. Then after, for zero matrix, if all the elements of matrix are zero, then the matrix is said to be a zero matrix and it is denoted by capital O. Okay, and we need to look out over here, that is, O is also the identity matrix for addition. That means if we add zero matrix to any of the non-zero matrix, then this identity can get satisfied, that is identity addition. Okay, so these are the types of matrices which we need to look out. Now let's explore further with the study of matrices, that is transpose of a matrix. Now what is transpose of a matrix? So if all the element, all the row elements are written in the column format, or all the, we can also say that all the rows are converted into corresponding columns, then the matrix we obtain, that is known as transpose of the given matrix. Okay, let's say if a matrix is written like this way, let's say if it is 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9, this is the matrix A. And if we are intended to find the A transpose, so A transpose, that means writing the given row in the column format. That is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. This is how we write the transpose of a matrix. Okay, it is somehow, sometimes it is also written as A dash. Okay, but general notation we use, that is A, and to the it is raised to T. Okay, this is how we denote it. Then after, symmetric matrix, that means if A transpose is equal to A for a square matrix, then A is called as symmetric matrix. Make sure the condition provided to us, that is symmetric matrix is always a square matrix. Okay, these kind of questions may come to you, that every square matrix is a symmetric matrix, yes or no. So you need to think upon it and then try to answer. So what is the condition for symmetric matrix? That if A transpose value is equal to A value, then we can consider that the matrix provided to us, that is a symmetric matrix. For skew symmetric matrix, what is the condition offered to us? That is, if A transpose value is equal to negative of A, then we can consider that it is a skew symmetric matrix. Okay, and here are a few of the identities for better understanding part, that is addition of two matrix, and if it is the transpose, if is to be taken for that addition of matrices, we can also write it in the form of these splitted way, that is A transpose plus B transpose. And if we take transpose of transpose, it will return into the original matrix itself. Okay, so these are the things we need to further explore in this matrices chapter. Now there is a shortcut technique to find the inverse of a matrix that I would like to guide you. Now let's say if any matrix is offered to us as minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, okay, then after 1, 1, minus 2, and 2, 4, 3. So this is the first, this is middle, and this is last. Just observe this trick carefully. Okay, just observe this trick carefully. How to simplify this? Let's have a look. Now we need to write like this way. So first I will write all the middle values. Okay, so that is 1, 4, minus 2, then after L, minus 2, 3, minus 3, and then after, once again, first value, that is 1, 2, minus 1, once again M, 1, 4, minus 2. Okay, so these things can be further, it can be further processed as, I need to write it this particular column, rewriting it over here, and then we need to perform further operations. What we need to do, we need to perform further operations. All right, so let's have a look. So to find, very first, to find the adjoint of A, what we do, that is 1 multiplied by 3, then after 2 multiplied by 4, minus 2 multiplied by 4, then after minus 2 multiplied by 2. Okay, then if you observe, the values are just accordingly arranged over here. If you observe the values, I will once again perform the animation to have a better understanding. Yes, I'm finding one query in the chat window that what is Hermitian matrix? Please tell me. Whatsoever your queries are, I will answer it on a later stage because we need to cover up many of the topics also. So first concentrate on this part and then we'll take further your queries in the next session if possible. Okay. So let's perform the operation once again. So 1 into 3, okay, that is 3, and we need to introduce a negative sign. We need to introduce a negative sign and then -2 into 4, that is -8. Now for next process, what we need to do, we need to take the product of 2, -2 and 2, that gives you -4. And then once again, what we need to observe, 1 into 3, okay, minus sign we need to take down over here, and this, like this way, we need to do the operation and this 3 value comes over here. In a similar way, the third element of this adjoint can be found out like this way. That is 1 into 4, I will write 4 over here, and this 1 into 2, I will introduce minus sign in between and then write 2 over here. In a similar way, the next column can be, it can be written like this way. That is 4 into -3 gives you -12, 3 into -2 gives you -6, but I need to introduce minus sign also. So minus sign I will introduce and then I will take the product like this way. Then after, my 3 into -1 is -3, and introducing minus sign and then taking the cross product like this way, 2 into -3, so it is -6. Then after, 2 into -2 is -4, so I will write -4 over here, and once again I will introduce minus sign over here. It will come down, just a minute. So minus sign, it comes down, and 4 into -1 is -4, and later on this -2 into -2 is 4, so that 4 will be the first element of the first element of the third row and first column. That is -2 into -2 is +4, and -3 into -1 is -3, but I need to introduce negative sign. So -3, then after -3 into -1, that is -3, minus of -1 into -2, that is 2. So that I have written like my 2 over here, and lastly -1 into -1 is -1, and minus sign will be introduced just over here. So -2 into -1 is -2, and then you can do the further simplification process. So this you need to simplify it, and it will result into like this way. That is, adjoint of A will be given by 3 plus 8, that is 11. In a similar way, you can find the other set of elements over here. And as you know that A inverse is nothing but it is adjoint of A upon determinant of A. So you also need to take a note of the determinant, and then you can find out the solution to the given question. So this is the shortcut way to find the inverse of a matrix. I believe this technique is well understood by each and every student attending it. Please provide confirmation in the chat window. Okay. So yes, I can find that one student wants to re-explain this particular step, so I will re-explain it, no need to worry. See, what you need to do is you need to write like this way, M, then you need to write the process like this, starting from 1, then you need to write 4 over here, and then -2, okay? Then after you need to write L, so L starting with the -2 element, so -2 comes over here, then 3, that is coming over here, and then -3, and then after F, that is starting from 1, then after 2, and then after -1, and lastly we will copy this M part and it will turn out to be M14-2. Now what you need to do, you need to rewrite this first column, okay? You need to rewrite this first column like this way, and then take the further simplification steps. Now simplification steps are very easy. What you need to do, just take the cross product like this way. First, they form the 3 cross 3 matrix. Then What you need to do, you need to take the product that is 1 into 3, that gives you 3, and minus 2 into 4, that is minus 8, but you need to introduce minus sign. Okay, you need to introduce minus sign over here. So minus sign into minus 8. Okay. All right. Then after, similarly, you need to perform for other operations also. That is minus 2 into 2, that gives you minus 4, and minus sign will be there in between, and then 1 into 3 is 3. So I will write 3 over here, and similarly 1 into 4 is 4, and minus 1 into 2 is 2. So 4 minus 2 I will write over here. In a similar way, we need to construct all these remaining two columns. I will do it quickly as a part of revision now. So once you form this, you obtain your adjoint of A after simplification. And then after obtaining adjoint of A, inverse is very easy. That is adjoint of A upon determinant of A. Okay. So this is the shortcut technique to find inverse of any given matrix. Now moving ahead with the important results part, that is for any non-singular matrix. Okay. The value of the reciprocal of determinant of A is same as the value of determinant of the inverse. This readily means that determinant of A inverse is equal to determinant of A, and I will take the inverse later. So both these things are same ultimately. Okay, this can be remembered as a part of MCQ type questions. Generally, in the MCQ type of questions, you will come across the questions which are formed specifically based on these results. Okay, you will find few of the questions that are directly oriented as a part of these results. Hence, these results are mandatory to get remembered before you appear for any of the examinations. Okay, anyways, let us proceed ahead. So if A and B are two non-singular, or both of them are non-singular matrices, so AB is non-singular, and then we can come to a conclusion that AB inverse is given by is equal to B inverse and product with A inverse. Okay, so for M cross N matrices, the third result is that if we are having the product of matrices as A and B, and we take the transpose of it, then it can also be equal to B transpose into A transpose. Okay, then after, if A transpose is non-singular, if and only if A is non-singular, and it follows the result as A transpose inverse is equal to A inverse transpose. And also the last result, which is the key part of our discussion, that is adjoint of A transpose, that is equal to adjoint of A the whole transpose. So these are few of the results which will readily guide you with the MCQs, which are results, these kind of results oriented. Okay, theoretical MCQs can be solved once you know these kind of results properly. Let's proceed further with the simplification of few of the problems based on matrices. That is, let's say if any matrix A is given as this format, that is 0, 0, minus 1, 0, minus 1, 0, and minus 1, 0, 0. The only correct statement it can satisfy about matrix A, that is, we need to check whether A is 0 matrix. So it is not 0. Okay. Then after, check for this condition, A square equal to I. Now let's try to find the square of this. So once you find the square of this matrix, I think you know the multiplication, how to multiply the matrix. So A square can be written as A product with A. And then you need to take the multiplication like this way. That is, the first row gets multiplied by first column. Then the second row, this element, then this element, and this element. All these are taken in product and then added. Okay, then we need to add these elements. And we need to write the first element of the resultant matrix. So once you do the multiplication operation, it will result into this kind of matrix, which is an identity matrix. So we can come to a conclusion that answer of question one is A square equal to I. Okay. Moving ahead further with the next question, that is, if A square minus A plus I equals 0, then inverse of A is what? Now to answer this, we need to take the I equal to A minus A square. That is, we need to shift this minus A towards that side, so it becomes plus A, and A square towards that side, it becomes minus A square. And then after, what you need to do, you need to follow one simple task, that is, you need to multiply both sides with A inverse. So once you do that, what will happen? A inverse, see, after ultimately A inverse into I will result into A inverse. Okay, this is the, since I is a multiplicative identity, so A inverse into I will result into A inverse itself. And once you take A inverse into A, it will remain as it is, and A into A into A inverse, that is A itself. Okay, so once you do the further simplification, you will come up to A into A inverse is I minus this term remains as it is, and then after it is A into A inverse is I, as A into A inverse is I, so A into I is once again A, and lastly we can come to a conclusion that I minus A. So A inverse is equal to I minus A is the final answer. So our final answer turns out to be I minus A. So this is how we need to follow certain simple steps for the simplification of these kind of questions. Now these are very common algebra oriented questions, though it is a kind of matrix, but you can apply the logic of simplification of common algebra. Okay. Now let's proceed further with the discussion of the next part of our topic, that is permutation and combination. Now when it comes to permutation and combination, the key fundamental which we need to look out, that is the fundamental of counting and the meaning of these two words, that is permutation and combination. See, as and when the meaning of this permutation and combination is to be considered, permutation means arrangement in real sense, okay, and combination means selection. So let's say if you are having you know, five articles with you, and you are supposed to arrange these articles in a pair. So how many arrangements can be formed? So that is a question which is related to the fundamental of permutation. And if it comes to you that, let's say if in a team of 16 players, 11 players are to be selected. So once you find this kind of word in question, definitely you are supposed to apply the fundamental of combination. So this is the key difference between permutation and combination, just for the sake of identification of type of problem. Now let's have a look at what the thing is provided over here. So fundamental principle of counting, in that we know this thing pretty well, that if an operation is performed in n different ways, and corresponding to it another operation is performed in m different ways, then total number of ways of performing both the operations is mn, and this is also true for more than two operations. Okay, now the another key point which we need to look out, that is factorial. Now what is factorial? Factorial is nothing but it's a product of the given numbers, ultimately it ends up to n. Okay, so let's say if you are intended to find the factorial of 5, so 5 factorial can be found out as 5 into 5 minus 1, that is 4, into 5 minus 2, that is 3, into 5 minus 3, that is 2, into 5 minus 4, that is 1, into 5 minus 5, that is 0. 0 factorial we need not to consider, okay? Up to n minus 1, we need to seize ourselves. Now, the resultant value which we obtained after simplification, that is 5 factorial, answer is 120. So, this is the ultimate part we need to look out as and when we are dealing with a factorial. And also one key result, that is 0 factorial, that is also equal to 1 factorial, that is given as the value 1. Okay, now let's have a look at the further part of the permutation, that is the number of linear permutations of n different objects which are taken r at a time. Okay, let's say if you are having total, as I've already illustrated, that you are having 5 articles and you need to for take it into a pair. So a pair includes 2 articles, so 5p2. Okay, and then for the further simplification of 5p2, we will apply this formula, that is n factorial upon n minus r factorial. So this 5p2 can be readily simplified as 5 factorial upon 5 minus 2, that is 3 factorial. Okay, and then you can go ahead with the further simplification steps. Now as a part of simplicity, I will do it 5 into 4, and then I will keep 3 factorial as it is, and below that I will write 3 factorial, and then this will get reduced, since 3 factorial expansion is 3 into 2 into 1, and the same expansion you get over here. So your final answer is 5 into 4, that is 20. So this is how you perform the operations for permutation, and these are the steps involved for simplification of permutation part. Now permutation, as and when repetition is to be considered. So number of permutations of n distinct objects taken r at a time with repetitions allowed, that is given by n raised to r. Okay, you can directly write it as n raised to r. And for permutation with alike objects, that means same category objects, that is if p1 objects are alike, p2 objects are alike, and up to we are having alike categories objects in a form of clusters. So if these things are found, then the number of possible arrangements of these kind of things can be done using this fundamental, that is n factorial upon p1 factorial, p2 factorial, p3 factorial, up to number of clusters you have it. Okay, so let's say if you are having 8 different articles, okay, you are having 8 different articles, out of which 3 articles are alike, okay, then we can consider that another 3 articles are alike, and rest 2 articles are alike. Okay, so 8 factorial upon 3 factorial into 3 factorial into 2 factorial, this is how you are supposed to take for this particular portion. Okay, proceeding ahead further with the fundamental of combination. So as and when this combination part is to be considered, we need to look out that the number of ways of selecting r things out of n different things, that is called as combination. So the formula is ncr. okay, it is read as ncr, that is equal to n factorial upon n minus r factorial into r factorial. That means, let us say out of 16 players, if 11 players are to be selected, so we can consider this as a part of example, and we will substitute the values of n and r, that is 16 factorial upon 16 minus 11 factorial into 11 factorial, and do the further simplification process, right? Then these are two important results which may guide us with the objective kind of theoretical objectives can be simplified based on this, that is NC1 plus NC2 plus NC3 up to NCN. If it is given to you, then the resultant is always 2 raised to n minus 1. In a similar way, if we have NC0 plus NC2 plus NC4 plus NC6, that means in the R value, we are having the even numbers, and towards the right hand side, we have the odd values as a kind of R values, then it is also having the resultant as 2 raised to n minus 1. So these are the two important results as and when the theoretical kind of multiple choice questions are to be considered. The further exploration on these results can also include the number of diagonals of a convex polygon with n sides can be given by NC2 minus n. Okay, so if you want to find the number of diagonals in a 5-sided polygon, so that can be found out using this formula. In a similar way, n points are given in a plane, no 3 of which are collinear, then the total number of triangles that can be obtained by taking these points as vertices of the triangle is given by NC3. Okay, so you can use this fundamental for these kind of questions also. And lastly, if n points are given in a plane, and then the number of line segments joining them can be found out using this fundamental, that is NC2. So these are the fundamentals which can be applied as a part of the geometry portion. Okay, in the geometry portion, we can apply the fundamentals of permutation and combination to compute the number of diagonals or the number of triangles or the number of line segments. Okay, so but we need to have these kind of inputs in our question. We need to have the number of sides in for the diagonals part, then we need to have number of points for the triangle part, and also number of points in a plane for the line segments part. If these things are given to us, then definitely we can come to a conclusion by using this fundamentals. The other set of results include these. Now since I am finding that we are running out of time, so at present what you can do is you can take a screenshot of this particular slide, okay, and you can confirm me in the chat window, because I need to cover up one more point, that is binomial theorem. Okay, so please take a screenshot of this slide and utilize these results in your examinations, okay, when it is asked. Okay, thank you for the confirmation. Now we'll proceed further with an example based on problem on permutation. Now let us say if you are provided that by using the alphabets of the word Monday, words blank words of four letters can be formed in which Y does not occur. Now see, we are already provided with one condition over here. What is the condition offered to us? That is, Y is not occurring. Okay, that means total we need to look out only five words. Okay, so here n value is 6, total number of alphabets we have, that is 6. One alphabet we need to neglect, so m value is 1 and r value is 4. See, we need to take out four letters. Okay, we need to form words of four letters. So what is the fundamental utilized? We need to use this formula, that is n minus m p r. This formula can be utilized for this particular kind of questionnaires, okay, wherein we are neglecting one alphabet or two alphabets. We are neglecting certain entities and then we are forming another set of entities from the given set of values. Okay, so n value you have 6, m value you have 1, r value you have 4. Once you substitute this in this n minus mpr, the final reduction turns out to be 5p4, and the simplification of 5p4 will give you the answer as 120. Okay, so it is 5 factorial upon 5 minus 4 factorial, and 5 minus 4 factorial, that is 1 factorial. 1 factorial answer is 1 and 5 factorial answer is 120. So your final answer is 120. Okay. For examination further queries, I request admiss team to kindly answer these queries on a later stage. At present, let me finish it off with the session, as since we are already running out of time. Problem on combination. Now let's say you are offered with problem like this way: in how many ways can a group of 5 men and 2 women be made out of total 7 men and 3 women? Now see, over here the application of selection comes into picture. Okay, over here the application of selection comes into picture. So as and when it comes to selection, we need to use the fundamental of combination. Now to apply this, the fundamental is very easy. Out of total 7 men, you need to include 5 men. So I will write 7C5. And also over here, AND operation is provided to you. So what does this AND indicate? It indicates multiplication. So I will take the product over here and then 2 women. Okay, so out of 3, 2 women are to be selected. So I will use 3C2. Okay, then I will do the further simplification process, and after simplification I will come up with the answer as 63. Okay, if you do the further simplification, you will come up with the answer as 63. Now moving ahead with the last part of our discussion, that is the binomial theorem. Okay, so binomial theorem, we need to, you are already knowing this theorem pretty well, that if the addition of any two different values A and B, okay, if the addition of any two different values A and B are to be found and it is having a power n, so for that NC0, we have NC0 A raised to n B raised to 0 plus NC1 A raised to n minus 1 B raised to 1 plus NC2 A raised to n minus 2 B raised to 2. And similarly, it will result up to NCN, A raised to 0, B raised to N. Okay. Now, general term in the expansion of A plus B raised to N can be found out using this particular result, that is TR plus 1. It is giving you the value of R plus 1th term. Make sure it gives you the value of R plus 1th term. And that value is given by NCR, A raised to N minus R into B raised to R. And this condition is to be kept in mind, 0 less or equal to R less or equal to N. Okay. So these are few set of results. See, binomial theorem is a chapter wherein you need to remember few set of results, and then you need to readily apply those results onto the given type of questions. Right. So general term in the expansion of A plus B raised to N, you need to remember this result. And similarly for middle term in the expansion. So for finding out the middle term, what you need to do, if the number of values are, if n is even, okay, if this value, if this power value is even, that is, let us say if it is 2 or it is 4, okay, so for that case, middle term value can be found out using this particular rule, that is tn by 2 plus 1 is equal to nc n by 2 a raised to n by 2 b raised to n by 2. Okay, see, it is similar to this particular thing. If you observe, only the difference happens is in this particular n by 2, okay, since it is even, r gets replaced by n by 2. Okay, and over here the power of a raised to n minus r is getting replaced by n by 2, and power of b, that is getting replaced by n by 2. So just observe one particular relation properly, and based on it we are supposed to, you know, form the other results. So it becomes easier for us and it reduces our task of remembering. All right, now similarly you can find the result which is provided for odd numbers, but we won't discuss it much since we are already out of time. So kindly take a screenshot of this particular slide and confirm it in the chat window. Okay, thank you for the confirmation. Few more results I have kept over here for your better simplicity. Now see, we have already seen a plus b the whole raised to n expansion. For a minus b raised to n, the expansion follows like this way. The only difference between them, that is the alternate of sign. If you observe, the alternate of sign over here, only plus positive signs are there, whereas over here negative, positive, negative, positive, and so on it follows. Okay, so once again, in the expansion of a minus b raised to n, the r plus 1th term, like we found in this particular case, for this case also r plus 1 term can be found out using, only difference comes over here, that is minus 1 raised to r will come just before ncr, and then it is ncr a raised to n minus r b raised to r. The formula is same if you look out. Okay, then this result is also of importance. 1 plus x raised to n, this expansion sometimes it gets directly asked as a kind of, you know, question part. So what is, they may ask you that what is the expansion of 1 plus x raised to n. So if you remember this, then it is a very win-win situation for you to answer it you know, rapidly. Then after, in the expansion of 1 plus x raised to n, if you wish to find the r plus 1th term, it can be found out using ncr x raised to r into, see over here, if I write 1 raised to r, then also it will return me the value as 1. So it is needless to write 1 raised to r, so I will directly write it as x raised to r. Okay, students can take a screenshot of this particular slide also and confirm it. All right, okay, thank you for the confirmation. Now we are on the verge of completion of our chapter. This is the last part of result slide. Once again I request to take the screen capture of this. Okay, now the general term in the expansion of 1 plus x raised to n, majorly they may ask you the questions based on this particular slide, that is find the general term in the expansion of 1 plus x raised to 2, okay, or 1 plus x raised to minus 2, or 1 minus x raised to 2, or 1 minus x raised to minus 2. So for that, what you need to look out, you need to have a note of this particular results, and then utilize this results in the simplification steps. That's it. Okay, and then you are done with the solution of your given question. So this is the last screen capture which I will recommend you to take it, and then we are starting off with the solution part of solution part of problem based on this binomial theorem. Once you are done with the screen capture, kindly notify me. Okay. Okay, so we'll find one problem based on binomial theorem, that is the coefficient of x raised to 10 in the expansion of 1 plus 2x raised to minus 7. That is given by what? So if you look out, the problem is of the form 1 plus ax or bx raised to minus n category. Okay, so if you find the problem is of the form 1 plus x raised to minus n, this category problem is offered to us. Okay, type number 3. So what is the formula which we utilize? Tr plus 1, that is given by minus 1 raised to r n, n plus 1, n plus 2, and so on, and it results into this particular format of expansion, right? So following this, we come to a further part of process, that is t raised to r plus 1. R value is given to you as 10. Okay, r value is given to you as 10. So t raised to r plus t of r plus 1, that is 10 plus 1 is 11. So I will write it over here, minus 1 raised to 10. If you observe the formula properly once again, see it is x raised to r minus 1 raised to r and n plus r minus 1 c r. This is the formula which we are utilizing it. Okay, so if you utilize this formula and put down all the given values, you will need to simplify this particular, that is minus 1 raised to 10 is, it is plus 1 since it is an even value, and negative of 1, if it is having even value as the power, it returns the value 1. And 2 raised to 10 comes over here, and then after take the simplification of 7 plus 10 minus 1, so it is 16. So it is ultimately 2 raised to 10, 16 c 10 x raised to 10. Now what is the coefficient? Coefficient of x raised to 10. So it is none other than 2 raised to 10, 16 c 10 is the answer. So answer is B. Okay. So with this note, we are hereby coming to an end of our today's session, that was on algebra portion. And I'm really thankful to Admis Tech team for providing me this wonderful opportunity to conduct the complex competitive examination classes.